Good evening, everyone. We're so glad you're here with us tonight at First Pres. To get y'all started, we just have a couple really quick announcements. The first is that every year we have an event that we all know and love, the Christmas Love Gift Dinner. This is going to be on December the 6th. This is a great chance for you to come together, eat food, fellowship, but most of all, hear what the Lord is doing in and through the mercy ministries of our church and to take part in that yourself. The dinner will be $5 at the door or $25 maximum for a family. The second announcement is our Evensong services are on December the 13th at 4:30 and 6:30. That's December the 13th at 4:30 and 6:30. And if you've been with us for a while, you know that every Sunday evening we go through a little bit of the Westminster Shorter Catechism. And tonight's no exception. We're on to question 76. And I'll read the question, and if you'll respond with me, the answer. What is the ninth commandment? The ninth commandment is, you shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. Hear the Lord's call to worship from 1 Kings 8:56. Blessed be the Lord, who has given rest to his people Israel, according to all that he has promised. Not one word has failed of all his good promises, which he spoke by Moses, his servant. And pray for us. Heavenly Father, we thank you that there is not a word that falls from your mouth that does not come into being. Lord, you speak and it is. You are the one who said, let light shine in the darkness. And Lord, we pray that you would shine here tonight, that your word would ring out, that our hearts would be ready to receive it, Lord, that it would find fertile ground in which to fall, and we would leave this place having encountered the living God. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand with us as we worship the Lord?
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. Joy to the world, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs implore. While fields and blood, rocks, hills and plains, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy. He rules the world with truth and
Tonight, we have the privilege of hearing what the Lord is doing through one of our own. Roger, if you would come forward. Roger and his wife, Rita, they have been missionaries all over Africa, in Zambia, in South Africa, Nigeria, and Rwanda, and the Lord is calling them yet again. This time, they're going to be going to work with a Korean residency hospital in Ethiopia, and I'm going to let him share a little more with y'all.
So 38 years ago this past Thanksgiving, I was saved. And any of you who are spouses probably remember the very first time you kissed your spouse. And when you receive grace, it's like God's kissed you. And 2.5 years ago, I was in the northwest corner of Zambia near the Congo and Angola meet. And I did a lymph node biopsy, stuck myself from an HIV patient. I had to go on HIV medicines, which put my kidneys in complete failure. And I had to be air flown to Lusaka for dialysis, and then I came here. And so I thought that was, I was through. And then I heard John Piper speak on missions. He said there was only three responses to the gospel: go, send, or disobey. So Caleb told me before I got up here, he says, I'm going to ask you why you're going. And I said, how can I? I can't not go. We're going to during Korean War, Ethiopia is one of the few countries that sent volunteers to fight for South Korea. And as an expression of their gratitude, Munsung Presbyterian Church went to Addis Ababa, the capital of Ethiopia, northeast corner of the continent, and they built a state-of-the-art hospital there. And there's 40 Korean families, will be the first non-Koreans, and the hospital employs 615 Ethiopians. And 4 years ago, they started a WHO-approved medical school, and they've asked me to come and teach the students, start an internship program, and then a family medicine residency program there. I can tell you that people ask me, why is Africa so special? It's a place where the terror of sin meets the gospel of grace head on. And as our pastor has been telling us, and we've all been listening, he told us this morning, he's told us every single evening, Sunday evenings for weeks now, five words: Jesus wins, don't give up. So my asking you to pray for me is that I wouldn't give up. My wife is going to be staying until April. My son's in Afghanistan, and we have the privilege of having our Korean daughter-in-law and our Korean-American grandson staying with us until my son comes back from Afghanistan.
Thank you, Roger. If the ushers would please come forward at this time. And while they're coming, I want to introduce tonight's preacher. Tonight we have the privilege of hearing from Dr. Larry Gilpin. Dr. Gilpin was the pastor at Westminster Presbyterian Church in Martinez for a long time, and now he is looking for a call, and he's here to share God's word with us tonight. So with that said, let me pray for our offering. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your grace. Lord, we thank you how you have blessed us so richly. Lord, as Roger just said, Lord, we have been kissed by grace. And Lord, I pray now as we respond that you would take these gifts and you would use them for your glory. Lord, you would use them for the expansion of your kingdom, for the making known of your name in ears that have never heard it and in hearts that have never believed it. And Lord, that we would see new sheep brought into the fold with every passing day. Lord, I pray specifically for the Lakeside Parish, for Brett Smith, for Lisa and Keenan Templeton, for Marcy and Jeremy Wells and their children Graham, Emmett, and Jacob, for Allie and Mike Wessner and their children Anson, Julia, Ella, and Caroline, and for Lauren and Tom Weemy and their kids Kristen and Anna, and Lord, and so many others that are there. Lord, we pray that you would lay your hand upon that entire parish, that, Lord, they would know each other by their love, that, Lord, your love would be so palpable, so present, so visible in their lives, that, Lord, they would delight to be in each other's company, and to a watching world, Lord, they would be a light. They would be a representation of what it is to have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And Lord, we pray you would protect them from the attacks of the evil one. We pray you'd protect them from any division that might sneak its way inside. And Lord, we also pray for Roger and Rita Holland tonight, Lord, as they prepare to go to Ethiopia. Lord, we pray that they would know that in everything they are doing, they are in the hands of a great and mighty Savior who will not let them go, who has said, all my promises have found their yes in Jesus, who is going to win, who is coming soon. And Lord, I pray that you would strengthen them for the road ahead. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
All is well, all is well. darkness fell into the dawn of love's light. Sing hallelujah, sing hallelujah.
All is well, all is well. Let there be peace on earth.
And Christ is come, go and tell that He is in the manger. Sing high.
Y'all stand and sing.
God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day, to save us all from Satan's power, and we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. In Bethlehem in Israel, this blessed babe was born, and they lived in a manger upon this blessed morn, of which his mother Mary did nothing take in store. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. God our heavenly Father, a blessed angel came, and unto certain shepherds brought tidings of the same, how that a Bethlehem was born the Son of God by day. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy.
Well, good evening. It's always a great privilege for Corley, my wife, and I to worship with you. Corley's a member here now. We worship here regularly. I'm still a member of Savannah River Presbytery, but it's such a joy to reconnect, as I'll mention in a moment, with so many of you, and again, to worship with you each week, Lord's Day morning and evening, and to be part of the life of this congregation. Just so some of you know who I am and what we're doing, I'm a PCA minister, and I have served as a senior solo pastor, or served as a senior solo pastor for a little over 28 years. I was most recently at Westminster PCA Church in Martinez for a little over 14 years. But the last year and a half of that ministry, as Corley and I began to think about and to pray about what God wanted me ministry-wise, what He wanted us to do this season of life and ministry, as I was getting a little bit older. Corley's no older, but I'm a little bit older than I used to be, and she will always be younger than I am. But we began to pray and really wrestle, and the more we prayed and wrestled, I really felt that God wanted me, that I had been in the right position as a senior solo pastor those 28 plus years, that God wanted me in some different type of ministry, still in the PCA, still in full-time vocational ministry, but something different, and felt I needed to step back for just a time in order to really be able to pray and really be able to assess what that next ministry thing was. I don't think I could have done that just being involved in everything ministry-wise. So it's been about a year and a half now, and God has, I think, clarified our calling for this particular time. I certainly have a heart for ministry to other pastors and seek to do that and want to increase in that in terms of ministry to other pastors in the PCA. But also I have a real burden for churches that are in transitions, that are in between pastors, and would really like to serve in a role as what you call an intentional interim pastor, not just preaching, but really getting a church ready for the next man. And so that's what we're seeking right now. There's some possible avenues upcoming that we'd still like to stay based in Augusta. That's our hope, and we'll see how the Lord works in that regard. But that's what we would like to do. But pray for us as we seek specifically the place where God wants us to serve us next in ministry. Corley and I both have connections that go way back with First Pres, both in our days when we were single, and then as a couple, we were both here at different times. I don't think we were ever in the same room. I think we barely missed each other. May have been in the same room one time when we were single, but then I moved to moved elsewhere, and she was here. But we were introduced by a wonderful couple who were longtime members of this congregation. Our first date was actually, part of it was in their home at dinner. The other part of our first date was down the hall in St. Andrew's Hall at a conference that Corley had helped to organize. So some 28 years later, things are still good, and we're very thankful for your ministry to us and the way He's used so many of you in our lives. I'm especially thankful for the pastoral staff and my friendship with them, their encouragement to me. I may say also, Dr. Bob Vasholtz is the greatest Hebrew professor in the world. I had him way back in the early, mid-80s, and just no one could be better in teaching Hebrew because I learned it, and that was it certainly is a credit to him. It's a privilege to look at God's Word with you tonight. If you would, turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 9. And I'm going to read verses 23 through the very first part of verse 43. Luke chapter 9, beginning in verse 23. Luke 9:23, speaking of Jesus, it says, "Then he said to them all, 'If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will save it. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world and yet lose or forfeit his very self? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of him when he comes in his glory and in the glory of the Father and of the holy angels. I tell you the truth, some who are standing here will not taste death before they see the kingdom of God. About 8 days after Jesus said this, he took Peter, John, and James with him and went up onto a mountain to pray. As he was praying, the appearance of his face changed, and his clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning. Two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor, talking with Jesus. They spoke about his departure, which he was about to bring to fulfillment at Jerusalem. Peter and his companions were very sleepy, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men standing with him. As the men were leaving Jesus, Peter said to him, "Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what he was saying. While he was speaking, a cloud appeared and enveloped them, and they were afraid as they entered the cloud. A voice came from the cloud saying, "This is my Son, whom I have chosen. Listen to him." When the voice had spoken, they found that Jesus was alone. The disciples kept this to themselves and told no one at that time what they had seen. The next day, when they came down from the mountain, a large crowd met him. A man in the crowd called out, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son, for he is my only child." A spirit seizes him, and he suddenly screams. It throws him into convulsions so that he foams at the mouth. It scarcely ever leaves him and is destroying him. "I begged your disciples to drive it out, but they could not." "O unbelieving and perverse generation," Jesus replied, "how long shall I stay with you and put up with you? Bring your son here." Even while the boy was coming, the demon threw him to the ground in a convulsion. But Jesus rebuked the evil spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father. And they were all amazed at the greatness of God. Let's pray together. Our great God, we pray that by your Holy Spirit you would grant to us that which we cannot gain or attain for ourselves, the true understanding of your word. May we grasp it, and as we look to your word, may we see and understand more fully the beauty of the glory and the grace of Christ. We ask it in Jesus' name, and all God's people said together, Amen. Over the past year and a half, Coralie and I have worshiped with a number of different congregations, both here in the Augusta area and other parts of the country, and in my case, even other parts of the world. One thing that you, as a church, need to know, need to understand about those other churches is that those other churches are basically perfect. People agree almost everything. There are virtually no problems. Their leadership, if there are problems, their leadership knows how to handle every situation. Their children don't make noise and disturb people in worship. Musicians never miss a note. It's never too hot, never too cold in the sanctuary. There's always plenty of money. People don't get sick. There's not a lot of sin in those congregations. It's almost as if those other churches have missed the fall. And if they were fallen, they don't suffer many effects of the fall anymore. But of course, that's a dream world. That's not reality. The reality is, in those other churches that we've worshiped with, people drop things in worship. They make noise. Cell phones go off during worship. Sometimes pastors' cell phones go off. Sometimes their microphones don't work. Sometimes it's too hot or too cold for people in the sanctuary, sometimes both at the same time. Sometimes they're misprints in bulletins. Sometimes elders forget things in the Lord's Supper. People are not always as friendly as you wish they were. Some of those congregations struggle with numbers in terms of people. Some of them struggle with financial needs. They have people, those congregations have people in them whose marriages struggle greatly. There are parents in those congregations who are dealing with very difficult issues with their children who are involved in some very harmful things. Eugene Peterson says every congregation is a congregation of sinners, and as if that weren't bad enough, they all have sinners for pastors. There are people in those congregations, those other congregations who don't know Christ, who need to know Him. There are those who do know Him but need to know Him better, but all of them are people who need the gospel to impact their lives. There are people in those churches who have mountaintop life and spiritual experiences, but they live in the valley of the everyday, what I would call the valley of brokenness. Brokenness is not sin, but it is the result of sin entering into the world. Our world is a broken world. You and I are broken people. We get sick. We age. Sometimes people are unkind to us. Sometimes people are disloyal to us. Families don't always function as well as we would like them to function. We live in the now and the not yet. We know there's a not yet still to come. Heaven is to come and it will be wonderful, but we aren't there yet. We aren't glorified yet. We're being sanctified. We're in the now. The not yet is still to come. And there is that tension that we deal with. We live in a world that is wrecked by sin, and we are part of that wreckage. We are broken people, shattered people. We live in broken, shattered places. That's who we are. That's where we live. That's where we minister. We are fallen, redeemed people in a world that is fallen, that is being redeemed by Christ. And we see that, I think, in the transfiguration of Jesus and then in what follows the transfiguration. We need to bear in mind the context of this passage. Just prior to the transfiguration, Jesus' disciples have made the first settled confession as to who He is. Peter says, "You are the Christ." He asks them, "Who do you say I am?" He says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus says, "Peter, flesh and blood hasn't revealed this to you. The living God has done that." And so they make that first settled confession as to who Jesus is. Then Jesus, for the first time, begins to tell His disciples of His coming suffering and death and resurrection. Now, in Matthew's account, Peter then rebukes Jesus. No, this can't happen. But Jesus then rebukes Peter for opposing the purposes of God. And then Jesus calls the disciples to self-denial and to suffering and calls them to lose themselves for His sake. And this section of Scripture teaches us about Jesus, who He is, what He came to do, how He would do it, and it presents also His call to us. Jesus is fully God. And yet Jesus, who is fully God, also meets us in our brokenness. And then He sends us into the brokenness of others. We need to see in this passage a high place and a low place. First, the high place that Jesus possesses, which is deity. The high place of Jesus as God. Look at verse 29. It says, "As He was praying, the appearance of His face changed, and His clothes became as bright as a flash of lightning." Matthew 17 adds that His face shone like the sun. Peter says in 2 Peter chapter 1, referring to this event, "We were eyewitnesses of His majesty." The glory of Jesus that He possessed from all eternity was, for the most part, in His earthly ministry, concealed. Now, he showed his deity. He showed the power of deity in healing people and casting out demons, in walking on the water and raising people from the dead, in feeding the 5,000 and the 4,000. But in outward appearance, his visible glory, for the most part, was concealed. But here, we see the place of Jesus, because that place of Jesus as deity shines forth. The disciples are getting a glimpse of the person of Jesus in his preeminence. Verse 30 says, two men, Moses and Elijah, appeared in glorious splendor talking with Jesus. You have here Moses, the giver of the law. Jesus is the one who kept the law perfectly. And the sacrifices of Moses' day were a shadow pointing toward Jesus' ultimate sacrifice for us. Elijah is representative of the prophets who pointed to Jesus. He's the one who fulfilled the law and the prophets, who is greater than any who came before him. In verse 31, we're told that they were talking with Jesus, and they spoke about his departure, the NIV says, which he was about to bring to fulfillment at Jerusalem. His departure. That's what the NIV, the ESV, the New American Standard Version say. The King James Version says they were discussing his decease, which he was to accomplish at Jerusalem. Literally, it says they were discussing his exodus. His exodus that he was going to accomplish at Jerusalem, meaning that complex of his suffering and death and resurrection and ascension. The salvation of those who exodused out of Egypt was dependent upon the exodus of Christ at Jerusalem. But he's here presented as one who is even greater than the law and the prophets who had gone before him. In verse 36, it says, when the voice, that is the Father's voice, had spoken, they, the disciples, found that Jesus was alone. They only see Jesus at the end. That's not just the end of an event, but there's a purpose, and they're only seeing Jesus. It's to show that he is superior to everything that went before him. He's superior to everything that happened before him. He's the supreme sacrifice. He, as God, gave the law in his human nature. He kept the law. He enables us to keep it. He is the prophet par excellence, superior to all others, because, indeed, he's God. Many of you may be familiar with the name Bart Ehrman. Pastor George has mentioned him before. Bart Ehrman is a professor of religious studies at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. For several years, he was chairman of the religious studies department there. He's still a professor there. Bart Ehrman, though he is a professor of religious studies, is a professing agnostic. He's a graduate of Wheaton College and Princeton Seminary. He says he professed to be an evangelical Christian during his teenage years, but he says, I moved from being a committed, church-going Christian to become an agnostic. I no longer know whether God exists, but if he does exist, I'm convinced that he is not the God I was raised to believe in, a God who intervenes in history on behalf of his people to answer their prayers and to save them from their pain. Ehrman also denies the deity of Christ. He wrote a book a few years ago entitled How Jesus Became God. He holds that Jesus never claimed to be God, but that early Christians developed that concept. His core argument is that Jesus was a mere man who gradually, over time, came to be regarded as more and more divine until he ultimately, in the fourth century, was regarded by Christians as the God of the universe. Now, Michael Kruger, the president of Reformed Seminary in Charlotte, has written a response to Bart Ehrman, and it's entitled, How God Became Jesus, meaning the incarnation as he entered human history. He discusses how Ehrman dismisses Jesus' own claims. Michael Kruger says, Bart Ehrman presents an expectation that if Jesus were God, he would always say it directly, something like, good to meet you, I'm God. Or be someone with a little name tag that says, hi, my name is God. Well, in fact, Jesus makes clear claims of deity. For example, in the gospel, in John's gospel account, and Ehrman rejects the truthfulness of that, as he does the rest of the scriptures. But Jesus also presents himself as God in other ways. He declares himself to be the judge of the world, who will sit on God's glorious throne, who reigns over angels, and who is the key to people's eternal destinies in heaven or hell. He claims the prerogative to forgive sin, which was a prerogative that the scribes in his day rightly regarded as solely belonging to God. And if you claimed to have that right to forgive sin and you didn't have it, you were blaspheming. Jesus claims in the Gospels to have such a special relationship with the Father that he can say, all things have been handed over to me by the Father. And he says, a person cannot know the Father unless the Son chooses to reveal him. And here, clearly, Jesus is shown as deity in his majesty and glory and splendor. And so the issue is, what role does he have in our lives? Those of you who are around my age remember the television show Happy Days. Remember Arthur Fonzarelli, Fonz? In the early episodes of Happy Days, Arthur Fonzarelli did not have a very large role. But over time, he was so popular that he gained a greater and greater role until he was really one of the co-stars of that show. The television show 24, Jack Bauer's fighting terrorism, has a great helper named Chloe O'Brien, who's helping Jack to defuse bombs and doing things with drones to save his life. And in the early shows of 24, Chloe O'Brien was not a major character, but over time, she was very important in terms of her character and the role she played. In music, there used to be Hootie and the Blowfish. Now it's pretty much Darius Rucker, okay? Those people, whether in fiction or real life, now they gained more and more prominence. They were the same people, but they were given a greater, more prominent role. Maybe they were in the shadows, later they were in the forefront. Now, if you've come to know Christ, or if you don't know him, he is who he is. He is preeminent. He and his word are now to have center stage. In verse 35, a voice came from the cloud saying, "This is my son, whom I have chosen. Listen to him." It's a significant instruction. It's a general instruction, but there's a context for it. Remember, the disciples didn't want to hear about Jesus' suffering and death. And yet, that's exactly what Jesus had set forth, and now the Father affirms Jesus' authority. And as he does that, he's actually looking back to Deuteronomy chapter 18, where God instituted the prophetic office. A prophet spoke the very words of God, and in Deuteronomy 18, God appointed began a long line of prophets that would ultimately culminate in Jesus, but prophets who would fill that office. And he said of the prophet, which culminated in Jesus, because ultimately he's pointing toward one, and that's the Lord himself, he said, "You will listen to him." Peter applies that to Jesus in Acts chapter 3, discussing the death and resurrection and ascension of Jesus. He says, "This is what Moses spoke about." And he reminds the early believers, "You must listen to him." God said that in Deuteronomy 18. Acts 3, it's applied to Christ here. The Father says, "You must listen to him." Because as God, Jesus speaks the very words of God. And his word will always lead us to the right place. Not always the easy place, but always the right place. And because the words of Christ are God's words, they have all authority. And because they're God's words, you can trust them, even when they don't make sense. You can trust his promise to forgive you, to receive you, if if you come to him. You can trust that he will keep you and never leave you nor forsake you. You can trust the wisdom of his word. You can trust his promise to build his church. Now, there's something specific that his word tells us by direct teaching and by the model of Jesus. We see the high place of Jesus as deity, but we also see here not only a high place, we see a low place. The low place where Jesus sends us and is also with us. And that's a place of brokenness. In verses 32 and 33, it says, Peter and his companions were very sleepy, but when they became fully awake, they saw his glory, that's what they're focused on, and the two men standing with him. As the men were leaving Jesus, Peter said to him, Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up three shelters, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah. He did not know what he was saying. Peter wants the glory of this moment to continue. He wants to build shelters. He's thinking this mountaintop situation is going to continue. We can stay, so let's do that. Let's build this. But he had already been told by Jesus of the reality of the cross, and now the Father says of Jesus, listen to him. And then they go down the mountain to a situation of immense, immense torment and affliction. Verse 37 says, the next day when they came down from the mountain, a large crowd met him. A man in the crowd called out, Teacher, I beg you to look at my son, for he is my only child. A spirit seizes him and he suddenly screams. It throws him into convulsions so that he foams at the mouth. It scarcely ever leaves him and is destroying him. I begged your disciples to drive it out, but they could not. You have a boy who's cruelly demon-possessed, and Jesus does what his disciples could not do. He defeats what his disciples could not defeat. He heals the boy. Jesus could have stayed on the mountain, but he didn't. He was God before he went up the mountain. He was God on the mountain. He was still God when he came down. But when he came down, he went into the brokenness, into a situation that was beyond the disciples. And he challenged their faith amid the brokenness, and he ministered and he healed amid this deep brokenness. Those of you who know me well at all know that I love sports. I especially love basketball, and I especially love college basketball. And I think it was the Lord's grace that I've been able to attend with Corley two NCAA Final Fours. We went 2 years ago in 2013 in Atlanta. We went in 1993. In New Orleans. Never thought I'd get to go. Been able to go twice. I say we go. Corley's gone with me. You know, you do things in marriage that you don't necessarily like to do that much, but because you love the people that you do them with. So I dance with Corley at wedding receptions, not because I love to dance at all, but because I love her. And she goes to Final Fours with me, not because she's a huge basketball fan, but because she loves me. That doesn't have a lot to do with Luke chapter 9, but there's some self-denial in there, certainly. But I remember the first Final Four we went to was in the Superdome in New Orleans. Those of you who follow college basketball know North Carolina won the national championship that year. They beat Michigan. That was the infamous Chris Webber extra timeout game when he called a timeout that he did not have, and so it resulted in a technical foul. North Carolina got free throws on the ball, and they were able to preserve the victory. It was a wonderful time. It was heaven on earth for me as a basketball fan. And when it was over, finally, when it was finally over, I did not want to leave. Now, we were up in the upper deck of the Superdome, way, way up high, but we were there. I was using binoculars to see most of the game, but we were there, and we stayed as long as we could stay. We stayed till the championship trophy was handed out. We stayed till the last cord was cut on the last net. We stayed till the teams were gone and most everyone else was gone, And it was basically time to turn out the lights. And so we finally had to leave. And I can remember going down the steep steps of the upper deck in the Superdome. And then I remember slowly, because I didn't want to leave, slowly walking down the ramps of the Superdome, and descending and going down and down and down and down and down until finally we got to ground level. And we went outside and basically then went back to everyday life. Now, everyday life wasn't bad, but it wasn't being up there watching the Final Four. As Christians, we have mountaintop times of life. We have mountaintop spiritual experiences. We have exciting times sometimes. We should enjoy them and glorify God in them and thank Him for them. But it is in the ordinary, in the everyday, in the routine, amid great brokenness, ours and others, in our families, in our communities, in our churches, it is there that most of our ministry is going to be carried out as instruments in the hands of Christ. We are the broken whom Christ heals, who have the privilege to minister to the broken. Timothy Locke is a PCA pastor in New Jersey, and he wrote in his blog a while back about one of the greatest lessons that he ever learned in ministry. One of the greatest lessons, he says, he ever learned was being the assistant pastor in a church of about 200 people where a retired, disabled minister would often preach. Even though, as Tim Locke would say, I was available to preach, but the elders would ask this brother to preach, and on Sunday morning, no less, they would ask him to preach. And he said the man would struggle through his sermon, encumbered by the effects of a severe stroke. But Timothy Locke says, I learned a great lesson as the body of Christ embraced this man's brokenness and lived the gospel in the community of faith. He goes on to say, if we believe the gospel, we won't run from brokenness or try to cover it up. We'll live in it. He says, I'm convinced that we shouldn't try to do everything we can to hide our weakness or to put our best foot forward. That's a form of hypocrisy that ultimately undermines the message of grace that we preach and alienates the very people we're trying to reach. Nor, he says, should we seek to build our identity outside of Christ. He says the gospel teaches us that our identity is in Christ. It isn't in our brokenness, even, but it is in the person and the work of Jesus to whom we are joined. Our identity is not in what we own. It is not in what we do. It is not in the best that we would offer to the Lord. Our identity is in the one, Jesus, who represents us before the throne of God. Now, don't hear tonight what I'm not saying. Recognizing brokenness is not living in defeat. Rather, it's a place of usefulness. Jesus meets us there with His grace. His grace extends to the downcast. It extends to the rejected. It extends to the despairing. It extends to the lonely. It extends to the one who has failed morally, spiritually. It extends to us when we're facing our own personal sin and its consequences. The scope of God's redeeming grace is sufficient to reach us in the brokenness. It is there that Jesus heals. It is there that He restores. It is there that He rebuilds. He meets you in your brokenness so that you then can minister to the broken. Jesus is with you on the mountaintop. And He's with you in the valley. The valley of brokenness is a place of hope where Jesus meets us with His forgiveness, where He meets us with His power against besetting sins we struggle with. It's there in the valley of brokenness that we have the hope that God gives as He meets us with His people who encourage us. And then He sends us into brokenness, and He is there. In his book, Broken Down House, Paul Tripp describes a house that the owner had just stopped caring about. It was dilapidated. Paul Tripp and his wife were visiting his wife's parents in Miami, and his father-in-law had an idea. His father-in-law wanted to go look at houses with the possibility of maybe ultimately buying one. So Paul Tripp went with him. Let me let him tell the story. He says, "We drove to the north side of Miami and into a rundown neighborhood. And already I was thinking, why would he want to own a house here? And I hadn't seen anything yet. As we wove our way through the ribbon streets, we came upon a lot that could have passed as a bomb site. And that's when my father-in-law stopped the car. The first thing that hit me was the condition of the front yard. The grass was beyond cutting. It needed harvesting. Scattered across the suburban savanna was a random collection of rotting mechanical debris. Old lawnmowers, decrepit appliances, rusting car parts were strewn everywhere. The house had at one time been painted white, I think. But time, sun, dirt, wind, and neglect had given it a sickly, grayish, yellow skin, mottled and peeling everywhere. The storm door hung at an odd slant, held in place by one rusty hinge. And while I was still trying to take it all in, my father-in-law turned to me and said cheerfully, 'Well, this looks promising.' He was taken aback. What exactly seems promising here? Well, they went in to look, and he says, 'The inside of the house actually made the outside look pretty good. As I glanced about me, there seemed to be nothing that was clean and whole. Every inch appeared stained and dirty. Every corner seemed filled with junk. Every feature of the house looked to be damaged in some way. It was overwhelming. As we sat on a filthy, sagging couch in the middle of this broken-down house, that puzzling sentence kept echoing through my mind, 'Well, this looks promising.' Well, within a few days, his father-in-law had secured the money to buy the house, and not long afterward, he moved in, and he began a complete and total restoration. And Paul Tripp says, 'I will never forget walking into that house after all the work had been completed. It was hard to imagine that it was the same house.' Our world is like that house. We live in the world in a broken-down house. That's the world in which we live. But I would also contend you and I are broken-down houses. But if you're in Christ, you are redeemed, and you are beloved of God, and Christ is remaking us. If you don't know Him, He can remake you. God remakes the broken, our broken-down world, broken-down people, broken-down whatever. And He ministers to us in our brokenness. Psalm 51 says, 'A broken and contrite heart, O God, You will not despise.' And then He sends us to broken people. He sends us to what Zach Eswine calls spooky people, like the boy in this passage. Sends us to spooky people and spooky situations. He sends us to awkward situations that we just really are not comfortable with and may never be. He sends us to people that are, with apologies to Kenny Chesney, more than a little messed up and not all right. He sends us to those people so that we might point them to Christ and the resources of the gospel. So think about, where are the ordinary broken places where you work, where you go to school, where you live? That's where Jesus sends you. That's where Jesus calls you to be. Point yourself, point others to Him, to listen to Him, to follow Him, to know Him in His life and death and resurrection, and to know His sufficiency to deal with guilt and with shame. He heals broken people. He heals broken places because Jesus was wounded. He was wounded in His exodus at Jerusalem. He bore our sin. He suffered the wrath
it deserved. He suffered the effects of it. He suffered the brokenness of it. Jesus became sin for us. He was broken for us in order to heal us. So that there would be, as Francis Schaeffer said, substantial healing in this life and ultimate healing in heaven. And he does that also so that we might be ministers of his healing. Jesus will allow you to have the mountaintop experience. But he, the one who is God, the one who is also our Savior, also sends us in our position as broken, yet redeemed, restored people. He sends us to the brokenness of others. So don't be afraid to go down the mountain to the valley of brokenness where people are and where Jesus is with them and with you. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you that as believers we can confess that though we're afflicted, we're not crushed. Though we're at times perplexed, we don't have to be despairing. Though we may be persecuted, yet we're not abandoned. Though we may be cast down, yet we're not destroyed. Because Christ is greater than our sin and greater than our brokenness, greater than the brokenness of the world in which we live. And so we pray that you would apply your word, the riches of his grace in the gospel, more fully, more deeply to us. Continue to transform us by your Spirit, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand and worship together.
Oh, come all ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Oh, come, let us
stretch forth your hands, receive God's blessing. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him. And may you abound in hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.